Thank you very much. Yes, the subtitle of this presentation could be an unprecedented race against the clock toward an Ebola vaccine. As disclosure, I am the principal investigator of an investigator-driven phase one trial in Geneva of the RVSV ZEBOV vaccine. This trial was coordinated by WHO and funded by the Wellcome Trust. And besides that, I have a strong dedication to public health. The race for us started in August 2014 when the Ebola virus disease outbreak in West Africa was recognized as a public health emergency and where the exponential increase of cases led to the fear that this would be totally out of control within a few weeks before the end of 2014. Laurent Kaiser coming back from Liberia really touched us with photographs and pictures of frontline workers which had really very little, if anything, to protect themselves. And this led to the idea that in order to curb the huge death toll of these frontline workers, vaccine prevention was possibly the only conceivable intervention. And it initiated the race toward an Ebola vaccine. At the time, there were only two potential Ebola vaccine candidates. Available, meaning GMP grade, ready to be used in human, and shown 100% protective in non-human primates. Both were vector vaccines expressing the envelope gene of the Zaire strain Ebola virus. The first candidate is the chimp adeno-free Ebola virus vector vaccine, which is a non-replicating vaccine, live but non-replicating, developed by the NIAID and licensed to GSK, and tested in the US, UK, in Mali, and in Lausanne, in Switzerland. Briefly, the preliminary published results have indicated this vaccine to be safe, with no serious adverse event, but frequent flu-like symptoms. Those comparisons in small initial studies in the NIH indicated that a high vaccine dose, around 2 × 10^11 plex-forming units, were required to generate antibody responses which would be in the high range and in a similar range to the one elicited in a protected non-human primate. Subsequent studies in Oxford and Lausanne confirmed this finding, indicating as well that this vector vaccine induces good T-cell responses, but that these do not last at a very high level for more than a few weeks. The fate of this vaccine is thus to be developed as a prime boost vaccine requiring at least two doses and a large primary dose in order to maximize potential vaccine efficacy. The second vector is often referred to the Canadian vector vaccine because it was indeed developed by Public Health Agency Canada. The core of the vaccine comes from the vesicular stomatitis virus illustrated here, which provided its internal genes as the vector and thus controls the replication pattern of this live replicating vaccine. The envelope of the vaccine is, the envelope of the vaccine is that of the Ebola virus envelope, and it is the antigen toward which immune responses are directed. This vaccine was developed initially by Public Health Agency Canada, then licensed to Newling Genetics and subsequently Merck, and 800 of these doses were donated by Public Health Canada to WHO to accelerate its international evaluation. WHO played a critical role in putting up a coordinated effort of a number of trials which aimed at generating within a couple of months data related that would inform the dose selection and also the safety profile of these vaccines. And these trials initiated in Germany, Lambaréné, Gabon, Kilifi, Kenya, and in Geneva had to totalize 250 study volunteers and thus allow support direct move to the phase three in West Africa. So this was the start of our trial, a phase one placebo-controlled randomized clinical trial of the RVSV ZEBOV vaccine which could not have taken place and would not have succeeded without the extraordinary dedication of Angela Huttner, Julian Dyer, Sabine Yerli, Laurent Kaiser, a number of other colleagues on the slide, and hundreds of generous volunteers who took risks and very generously dedicated their time and also quite a lot of blood and various samples. These, they should be acknowledged and thanked for this generosity, which we promised to do every time we would present results in public. So the race started end of August with the demand from WHO to the institution. As Laurent said, we accepted 2 weeks later, and within 1 month, we had a protocol ready for the ethical committee review and for our regulatory authorities. In Switzerland, regulatory authorities are known to be as quite strict, so this implied very intense discussion, and I would like here to acknowledge their support. It has been extraordinary. Within 1 month, both the ethical committees of WHO and our institution and the regulatory authorities had approved the trial, which was designed in a very simple manner. We simply meant to randomize volunteers to either of two doses, the dose which had been shown as protective in non-human primates, 10 to the 7, or an empirically 5 times higher dose, or placebo. Our objective was to screen the subject and then give one single shot, and then followed, of course, at very regular times in order to monitor everything that was to be monitored. The objectives were extremely ambitious for anyone who has ever done such a trial. Within 1 month, we were expected to generate the first safety results. By the end of January, the first immunogenicity results were expected for dose selection, and the objective was to be able to initiate trials in West Africa by the end of February. This imposed on us an unprecedented pressure to enroll up to 15 subjects per week, whereas usually phase one trials include 15 subjects in total over a period of several months. So 15 volunteers were screened, enrolled, immunized, and followed every week. Until 1 month later, on December 9, we ran into the unexpected observation of several cases of arthritis, which, with onset in the second week after immunization, which were at the time not understood at all, not expected, and which led us to a temporary safety-driven study hold. Again, working against the clock, despite the holiday break, on January 1st, 2015, we had again ethical committee and regulatory approval to resume our trial at a much lower dose of 3 times 10 to the 5th PFU, which we will call the low dose. So our randomized controls trial was supposed to be very straightforward and easy, and in fact ended up as being quite complicated. Before the study hold, we immunized 35 volunteers with 10 to the 7 PFU, 16 with 5 times to the 7, and a few placebo. And these results have been published on April 1st, 2015, in the New England Journal of Medicine, together with the first results of our colleagues from Hamburg, Germany, Kilifi, and Lembarene. In these coordinated webcam trials, we had enrolled 158 individuals, of whom 138 had been followed for at least 4 weeks. These participants were healthy adults, aged between 20 and 64, mean age 36 years, and they received doses ranging from 0.3 million to 50 million PFUs. The first observation which we made is that on the next day of the immunization, we knew who had been the placebo or not. Those coming with subjective and objective fever and symptoms were readily identified, and this is why. You see here the vaccine viremia monitored by PCR in the blood of subjects immunized with immunized with either a low dose on the upper left in Lembarene at the time, or the higher vaccine doses. And you see very similar curves. Viremia kicks in very early, usually on day one, increases or plateaus until day 3 and is essentially gone by day 7, with a clear effect of the dose of the vaccine on the magnitude and the frequency of viremia. This vaccine viremia triggers reactogenicity, and very few volunteers had no adverse event at all. But most of the adverse events were mild or moderate. Here you see that fever, here for our trial on the right, 25% of our volunteers had mild objective fever, and 60% had a feeling that they were feverish on the day after immunization. Mild and moderate flu-like syndromes were also observed, including myalgia, headache, fatigue, and these were observed at various frequencies across the study trials, of course, with slightly different investigating procedures despite trial harmonization. So frequent adverse reaction, expect a lot of fever on day 1, but essentially gone by day 3. Following after the study hold, we were able to recruit another set of 56 volunteers and eventually ended up with 51 high-dose volunteers and 51 low-dose volunteers just by chance of randomization. And this allowed to better characterize the adverse event. Interestingly, at the low dose, adverse events were placebo-like. You see here that local pain, objective and subjective fever, chills, myalgia, fatigue, and headaches were not significantly different in vaccinees compared to those who received placebo. And this was very different with the high doses, which are currently used in the field, which induced a much higher magnitude and intensity of this acute reactogenicity. So a clear dose effect identified here. Immune responses were also dose dependent. Here, for those who are not used reading these reverse distribution cumulative curves, this is how it reads. You have here the proportion of subjects with antibody titers above an increasing titer. And you see that before immunization, most volunteers lacked any antibody against the Ebola GP, although there were a few outliers. Following immunization, all had responded with at least some antibody response with similar titers regardless of the high doses and lower titers for the volunteers immunized in lumbar NA with the lower vaccine dose. And the same was true when we looked at neutralizing antibodies. Here you see more clearly, on the right you have the red curve for those who, volunteers who received the highest dose, and on the left you have the black curve of the volunteers who received the lowest dose. And there is indeed clearly a gradient, the higher the dose, the higher the titers of neutralizing antibodies. And basically this is what led to the selection of a high dose, 2 × 10^7 PFU of this vaccine for subsequent phase 3 trial in West Africa. So far, so good. We were fulfilling our mandate and mission, and unfortunately, there were a few unexpected events that we hadn't expected. The first unexpected finding we didn't expect was arthralgia. In the second week following immunization, 20% to 25% of our vaccinees, regardless of the dose, returned to the CTU complaining of joint pain, swelling, mostly mild or moderate, inflammatory, migrating from one joint to the other. 2 to 4 joints per subject were affected. The onset day was day 11, always in the second week, and the duration was about a week for the first group, but as long as 3 weeks for the second group. So the dose reduction of the vaccine did not reduce at all the incidence of arthritis. What was the etiology of this arthritis? First, we confirmed that it was arthritis by imaging, synovitis, tenosynovitis, and bursitis. The biology was uneventful, and it is arthrosynthesis which was performed and possible in a few cases, 3 volunteers, which identified the presence of the vaccines in the joint at time of inflammation. So this led us to the diagnosis of a dose-independent viral arthritis. Second unexpected finding was dermatitis. Dermatitis was often maculopapular, but sometimes vesicular, as you see here with small vesicles, mostly or exclusively on the hands and feet of a study subject. This also occurred in the second week following immunization, and histology examination of punch biopsies of these sites indicated a lymphocytic infiltration, which you see here is of CD4 T cell lymphocytes, and you may here see the red cells, which are in fact full here, full of virus. So this is the vaccine virus in the skin at distance of injection, of course, because this was essentially found on the hands and skin. So those independent viral dermatitis confirmed by histology, PCR, and even infectious virus, as we were able to cultivate one vaccine virus out of a toe vesicle 2 weeks following immunization. The third finding not yet reported was the observation of cutaneous purpura and petechiae on the lower limbs, always in the second week following immunization in two subjects, fortunately with rapid resolution, no systemic involvement, so the diagnosis of localized vasculitis of the skin. And here again, thanks to the generosity of our volunteers, we could perform punch biopsies, and you probably see here well that the skin is fine with no dermatitis at all, but you see this intense infiltration of lymphocytes, CD4 lymphocytes, around the small blood vessels of the derma, and this is the diagnostic of lymphocytic infiltration and lymphocytic vasculitis. One of these two cases, this one, the punch biopsy identified virus RNA at the site of the biopsy deep in the derma, confirming that this was indeed vaccine induced. So how do we understand these unexpected events? Today, and we may be smarter tomorrow, but today this is our understanding. Vesicular dermatitis is classical of wild-type vesicular stomatitis virus. This is the replicating vector responsible for the early reactogenicity, and we presume that the maculopapular or vesicular dermatitis that we observed is mediated by the targeting of keratinocytes by the vaccine virus. As you've seen, we see the antigens in the skin biopsy. In contrast, arthritis and vasculitis are not part of wild-type VSV disease, whereas, and thus are an intrinsic property of the RVSV Ebola vaccine. We presume, but cannot prove it to date, that joints are targeted by the virus early during the course of the disease through the targeting of monocytes, the infection of monocytes, which then migrate to the joints. It is also known that the ZEBOV GP has a preferential homing or targeting for endothelial cells, and it makes sense to us that these are the organs in which we find the virus. So this means that we have here a truly chimeric vaccine, immunogenic, but reactogenic. And of course, the difficult question was or is the vaccine sufficiently safe and effective to be used in West Africa? So, as we all know and are happy to know, the size of the outbreaks eventually has resumed, and we are progressing toward outbreak control after 1 year and a very large number of cases and deaths. So in this setting, performing phase 3 efficacy trials in the affected areas becomes extremely difficult. Last week, a total of 31 cases were confirmed with Ebola virus disease. So how do you do to now go and test these vaccines and show whether they are effective or not in such a setting? Currently, there are 3 ongoing phase 2-3 trials in West Africa. The first is the NIH PREVAIL study in Liberia, including VSV ZEBOV and the chimp adeno vaccine. There was initially a phase two randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial which enrolled more than 600 subjects initially and then was continued to an expected target of 1,500 subjects. And the plan was to continue with the phase three study in Liberia, which had to be canceled because there were no more cases. So we have heard that the RCT has been moved to Guinea, but it is difficult to have observed information related to the trial at the time, so I don't know more about this. The second trial is driven by the CDC. In Sierra Leone, they selected VSV above, and the study is a phase three study of a modified stepwedge design, which meaning that the frontline workers, a target of 6,000, receive the vaccine either immediately or 6 months later, and are followed to define whether they get infected or not. And the third design, the third study, is a WHO-sponsored study in Guinea, also with VSV above, which was initiated on March 3 with a phase 2, which recruited for extended safety monitoring frontline workers, and is now ongoing with a ring vaccination design, with the intention to recruit 10,000 subjects in 250 rings. I don't know, I am not sure that you know exactly what a ring is and what this trial is. And this is indeed a very interesting concept which was generated from the smallpox eradication experience. A ring is the geographical setting where a newly diagnosed case of EVD resides and where it is anticipated that most of his or her contacts and the contacts of his contacts reside too. So it can be a village, it can be a suburb, it can be a compound. It is identified like that. And the trial of this study is as such, as soon as a new case of EVD is diagnosed at the center, the ring is defined, informed consent and randomization proceeds. Which means that not the patient, of course, but all his contacts and the ring are allocated either to immediate vaccination or to delayed vaccination 3 weeks later. The follow-up for outcomes continues and comparisons among the vaccinated immediately or 3 weeks later, but as well the eligible not vaccinated or the non-eligible should allow defining whether there is a vaccine efficacy and effectiveness and at which level. And this is currently the smartest design that you can think because you really focus on where a case is and where the context of this case are living. So many hopes on this design. So where do we stand today with Ebola vaccines? Within 10 months, two candidate vaccines which were sitting in deep freezers have been brought through phase one to phase two and three trials, mostly the RVSV Zebov vaccine as a single dose strategy, but also the GSK chimp adeno vaccine. There are three other candidates in phase one clinical trials with the prime boost strategy by GSK or Johnson & Johnson, or virus-like particles decorated with glycoprotein of above a strategy followed by Novavax. In addition, the pipeline, which was empty a year ago, is absolutely full of you name it type of original approaches with additional candidates. And so I think it's fair to say that this has been an unprecedented race around the clock to address this public health emergency. And we can only hope that the efforts will allow and enable the demonstration of the safety and the efficacy of these vaccines now in this current outbreak. If it has to be postponed to later, it will be much more difficult. And an option that no one wants to consider is that this may become never, because everyone agrees that we do not want to live through another Ebola outbreak without an effective and safe vaccine to offer, at least to the frontline workers. Thank you for your attention.